This is bad. I'm your host, Steve Van Meter, and thanks for joining me today. In our lead story today, what Starbucks just announced will leave you speechless. I'll show you what Starbucks just said and why it's an ominous warning for the entire U.S. economy. Plus, are we on the verge of another 2000-style dot-com bust? I'll show you why one sector of the economy says yes. And while most people believe that housing prices won't come crashing down, I'm going to give you conclusive evidence of why we're on the verge of another major housing bust. And with that, let's head over to Bloomberg, where we picked today's story up with a headline, "As Starbucks Falls After Warning That Sales Slump Is Getting Worse." And this is something we shouldn't hear happening, because after the Fed cut interest rates by 50 basis points, what happened is inflation went up, non-farm payroll surged, and then everybody, economists, central bankers, all these experts from around the world came out and said that the Fed overdid it. There was not necessary, that we are now achieving the mythical soft landing, and this was validated as stocks surged higher. Yet what Starbucks is warning is the economy isn't getting better. In fact, it's about to get much worse. The coffee chain reported a 7% decline in same-store sales in the fourth quarter ended September 29th. The weakness was especially evident in the U.S., where transactions were down 10% from the prior year, and in China, where comparable sales fell 14%. And keep in mind, those numbers aren't inflation-adjusted. And we know this is an issue that I've been warning about, because when incomes go down and prices stay high, consumers have no choice but to cut their discretionary spending. Starbucks, now a victim of a slowing economy, and warning that things are going to get worse. Because when we look at broad retail sales, we talked about since 2022, they've been relatively flat, although slightly negative. But look at what you're seeing when you start to focus in on real retail sales in the food services space. You see they're massively negative, and this has major implications, because what this suggests is what Target is facing is an issue that's going to lead to store closures. It's going to lead to changes and layoffs. But what about the broad restaurant space? We're hearing a lot of restaurants struggling financially, not being able to get customers in the door. And it makes perfect sense, because when people have less money, the first thing they cut is eating out. And we can look back as we look at total income, shown in red, which is average hourly earnings multiplied by average weekly hours of production of non-supervisory employees. And you see that against advanced real retail and food services sale, shown in blue on a year-over-year rate of change. And as consumers start to have less money, you see their spending power start to decline. The first place, again, they cut is eating out. You see that evident going in the dot-com bubble. You see it happening again going in the global financial crisis. And this time, what we're facing is likely a large wave of restaurants and chains that are going to fail. And this is not, of course, their fault. The demand is there. People just can't afford it, so they have no choice but to stop eating out. It's going to lead, of course, to more bankruptcies. It's going to lead to a lot of job losses. And some of these are not coming back. And Starbucks said withdrawing guidance for the current fiscal year will give the new CEO an opportunity to assess the business and solidify a turnaround plan. Because the guidance at this point is they don't have an answer. And that's the problem, is if they were to say, hey, based on what we're seeing right now, things are going to get worse, it would send their stock price absolutely crashing. And that's a danger. Companies don't want to do that. What they're hoping is that they believe that there's something they can do internally that's going to somehow turn around their whole business. The problem that Starbucks is facing, it's about the U.S. economy. It's going the wrong direction, and it's starting to accelerate to the downside in a big way. And fourth quarter sales decline was twice as steep as analysts had expected, and the biggest quarterly drop in 4 years. So we've talked about, you know, at what point is the U.S. economy going to hit an inflection point where U.S. consumers are finally tapped out, that they really need to start saving more money because they're concerned about the labor market? Well, my friends, based on what Starbucks is saying, it's happening right now. And Starbucks said that a push to launch more products and offer a plethora of promotions failed to bring in more customers to the stores. So it's not an issue of, we don't have the right products for you. That wasn't the problem. It wasn't about, hey, we're going to give you some discounts to come in. They weren't big enough. That's the issue. We're just getting a very clear view now of how cash-strapped U.S. consumers are. And as we look across the restaurant space, what we're seeing is evidence now that the U.S. economy is facing the same problems as it did right before the 2000 dot-com bust. As TGI Friday seeks new financing in preparation for bankruptcy, here goes another restaurant chain. As TGI Fridays is seeking financing as a casual dining chain prepares to file for bankruptcy protection in the coming weeks. After struggling to turn around a business pressured by customers' tighter budgets and preference for faster food. Now, is it an actual preference for fast food? I don't believe that at all. But if you think about this, if you go to a fast food restaurant, what do you generally know? And that's exactly what you're going to spend. But if you go to a restaurant like TGI Fridays, you might have a drink or two. There could be dessert, an appetizer, a tip. You never know what you're going to spend, and all that adds up. Again, consumers know how much money they have, and now they're limiting themselves to places where they know they can control their spending. This is, again, a huge warning for the U.S. economy. But if you're looking to make extra money as conditions tighten up, check this out. Our subscribers yesterday got stopped out for a whopping 24.97% gain. Here's the best part. All they did was place the initial trade and bump their stop loss level up. And then they got stopped out and made money. Didn't have to sit in front of their screens all day. Now, how do we do this? We have two ways to help you trade and make more money. One is our CTA time or pro product. We look at machine positioning for the broad equity, bond, currency, and commodity markets. We run a historical overlay and a full back test. We teach you how to trade against the machines and win. But maybe you like to trade momentum, and we take those momentum indicators. We aggregate them together, a proprietary overlay. We run over multiple time scales with a full back test. We teach you, again, how to trade momentum and win. But here's the best part. I have now disclosed a recent trade to my subscribers. You want to know what I'm trading? Well, you got to get in on it because it's up, and I think it's going to go up even more. Now, what do you get? The daily reports, tradable signals, my opinions on the best trades. I didn't even tell you what trades I'm doing. Full back test data, stop loss levels, full tracking of all the trades, a weekly update, a 30-day free trial so you can get on that. You could have made that money on uranium and not paid a penny. So you can get on this, duplicate everything, and you get to know what my trades are and why I'm doing it. Links in the description below. Get on board, because as we look around, people are going to be looking for money, and I'm going to show you how to make it. Because Red Lobster entered bankruptcy in May after years of losses, punctuated by money losing endless shrimp promotion, as if we couldn't see that one coming. It's kind of obvious as consumers look for bargains, and giving away unlimited food is a good way to go in bankruptcy. How about Hooters, the dining chain famous for chicken wings and Skippy uniforms, is also in talks with lenders and advisors as its declining revenue forces it to close locations. And so what we're seeing here is the early signs of exactly what happened going to the dot-com bubble. Now, I happen to live in, of course, what is the world's largest vacation destination. I know lots of people that work in the restaurant and hospitality space, and what they're all telling me is the same thing we're seeing here. They're saying there's not enough people coming in, and those that aren't spending as much, and bosses are cutting hours, they're cutting jobs, and this is causing a scramble because a lot of these people work two jobs to begin with. Now they're being forced to find a third. And going back decades, this year is set to come second only to 2020 for the number of restaurant chains and operators declaring bankruptcy. Traditional restaurant chains like Red Lobster, Buca di Beppo have had to resort to court-facilitated restructuring, but so have fast casual chains like Roadie, Tijuana Flats, and fast casual taco chain Rubio's. Same-store sales traffic at U.S. restaurants was now down 3.3% year-over-year this month, according to Black Box, and casual dining restaurants saw visits fall 4.5%, suggesting, as we've said, it was only a matter of time before consumers ran out of money. And there's even further evidence as we now look to Coca-Cola, who raises their outlook, but continued price hikes are only causing their sales to go up. But the question is, for how long? And while other food and beverage retailers have started to lower prices, Coca-Cola has continued to charge more for its products. The company's price mix, or the prices it charges across a range of products, have increased a whopping 10% in the quarter. And that's pushed revenues up above expectations, but consumers are increasingly reticent to pay up, particularly for juices, waters, and sports drinks. Sales volume were down or flat across most regions, and likely now to head even lower. But many people say that's okay. We're going to see travel dominating consumer spending, but Hilton's saying maybe not the case, as Hilton lowers profit outlook with travel demand growth slowing. As Hilton's revenue per available room increased by 1% in the U.S., keep in mind, not inflation adjusted, to the same period a year earlier, that compared to a 7.3% gain in Europe and a decline of 3.4% in Asia Pacific. So again, we're seeing evidence now as across the board, restaurant chains are saying things are getting worse. Coca-Cola is only able to push across an increase in revenue due to price gains, which will likely be rejected. Hilton saying travel is declining, and that caused, of course, the market to react. based on everything they're seeing, based on the fact that we're believed now to be achieving a soft landing, what everyone's now done is jump on the treasury trade, at least to the short side, but that's causing havoc in the housing market. But that's not the only issue facing housing. I've got conclusive evidence I'll show you here in a moment of why housing prices are also likely to come tumbling down. As treasuries plunge like it's 1995, as traders see the soft landing, too bad they're not seeing it from the restaurants. Of course, maybe the ones near them are closed. As U.S. mortgage activity gauges drops to the lowest level since August. To what we see here is traders and investors go massively short treasuries, drive prices down because they think interest rates need to go up. They don't believe the Fed's going to keep cutting. And look at their reaction. All of a sudden, mortgage demand fell. And Mortgage Bankers Association gauge of home purchases declined 5.1% in the week ending October 18th, making it the third straight decrease. And this is a direct reaction to traders driving interest rates up. Again, thinking we're going to hit a soft landing. But if that was the case, then why are buyers backing out? It doesn't make sense unless you believe that traders are on the wrong side of this. The refinancing index retreated another 8.4% last week after slumping the most since March of 2020. The contract rate on a 30-year fixed mortgage held steady at 6.52%. A month ago, it stood at a two-year low of 6.13. So 0.4% is all it took for people to change their mind. That's staggering. And of course, again, further evidence that traders have got this wrong by driving interest rates back up. All they're doing now is forcing the U.S. economy into a recession that's already on the path into. And now we turn to U.S. previously owned home sales as they fall to an almost 14-year low as a National Association of Realtors report showed a 1% drop in September. So again, higher rates, slowing economy. But remember, we talk about home builders. They're super bullish. They're building a lot of inventory. They're sitting on a lot of inventory. They think if you build it, people will come. I'm going to show you why the builders have got this wrong. They're going to be slashing prices. It's going to affect the resale market in a huge way. As many buyers and sellers are waiting for home financing costs to fall from their current perch in the mid 6% range. Mortgage rates, which slid to a two-year low in September, have climbed after recent job market inflation data boosted bets that the Federal Reserve will take a more gradual approach to reducing borrowing costs. But keep in mind, history says when the Fed starts at 50, it's going to get worse because what's coming for the housing market will be every bit of ammunition the Fed needs to cut rates and do it aggressively. As we take a look at new privately owned units started, this in blue, against total incomes in red, which is, again, average hourly earnings multiplied by average weekly hours of production of non-supervisory employees. That's shown on year-over-year rate change. And I want you to see the very clear relationship that housing starts coincide with rising income. So as consumers have more money, well, they want to buy a new home or trade up or move somewhere else. And you see that evidence, and the two move in cycle with each other. But there's one notable point we can look at here. Going into 2000, what do we see? A big run-up in housing starts as builders said, hey, if we build it, you'll buy it. But look what happened to incomes. They fell, and builders kept building, and yet incomes did go up, but they didn't go up fast enough. It began the crash in the housing market, and then what happened? Income started going down. Of course, layoffs hit the real estate space. Next thing you know, you're in an all-out housing bust. But how about this time? We're seeing incomes continue to decline. Housing starts are remaining elevated, particularly at a time when inventories remain very high. What this is setting up now is a huge bust in the housing market as those who are stuck in their home, they can't move because they don't want to get a higher interest rate, and builders sitting on massive inventories with huge margins that they can cut prices on. And even with weaker September sales figures, factors usually associated with higher home sales are developing. There are more inventory choices for consumers, lower mortgage rates than a year ago, and continued job additions to the economy. Except what if one of those was wrong? And what if the job situation was far worse? Some 1.39 million homes were for sale in September, up 23% from a year earlier. The supply of homes still remains below pre-pandemic levels. And at the current sales pace, available inventory would last 4.3 months, the longest in more than 4 years, as things look to get worse for the real estate sector. And here we can see the effect that what really drove the hammer down in, of course, going into the global financial crisis, we see that incomes fell and that drove housing starts down. And then as the unemployment rate started to rise, it was, of course, the nail in the coffin. It sent housing starts crashing, home prices crashing. We're seeing that same setup again, rising unemployment at a time of massive inventory levels is setting up the stage again for what I believe will be a huge housing burst. But that means, of course, central bankers are going to cut. Despite what Wall Street is saying, the Bank of Canada cuts 50 basis points to stick the landing, but I think they've got it wrong. I think the Bank of Canada is just reacting to the Fed because we want to see growth strengthen. Today's interest rate decision should contribute to the pickup demand, but what if it doesn't? And that's the thing. We've seen throughout history that Fed rate cuts don't actually do anything. Now, we got some data last month that said, of course, the Fed cut rates mid-month, and next thing you know, we see a big surge in jobs. We see also, of course, retail sales jump. But of course, you can't say it had anything to do with the Fed because they cut mid-month. There's no way it mattered. We took a bigger step today because inflation is now back to 2% target and we want to keep it close there. No, the reality is for Bank of Canada and for every central banker, the global economy is slowing and the only thing they can do is cut rates and pray. The problem is, just like history says, it's not going to work, which is why what we're seeing at Starbucks right now with a big decline in sales is a huge ominous warning for the economy, suggesting that we are indeed now in the early stages of recession and things, my friends, are about to get much worse. And with that, I'm Steve Van Meter. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being fans. Bye now.